That's interesting because, like, as you can see, they move differently, obviously, right? The limb lengths, you know, the levers that they have. When you're, like, when you're putting together a program, I know you do what's called microdosing. Can you go ahead and hit on that a little bit more?
Yeah, so microdosing is really simple. It's, let's just imagine a 3 times a week program.
Okay.
You have day A, day B, day C. Okay, they're probably spread out throughout the week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday. Let's just assume that you have your warm-ups, then you have, like, you know, your calisthenics, you have your sprint work or your change of direction or whatever work you're doing that's more movement based. All right, and then we're going to go power, we're going to go strength, and then we're going to finish with accessory work. That's generally everybody's program, right? Especially in athletic performance. So all we do is take that exact same program, except we quarter it and then we spread it out throughout the entire week. So instead of training 3 days, we train 6 days. So we just double the training frequency, but it's still the same amount of training volume, training intensity. So what that allows you to do is to be able to, from a motor learning standpoint, be more involved in the weight room, have more exposures at smaller dosages. And I mean, let's be honest, man, like guys who lift really, really heavy, if you ask them like, okay, all you got squat today, they're probably going to go pretty ham on that squat.
Yeah.
And then, and so now I'm getting higher intensities over more frequency. So if I was back in college and I did that same, well, being in college and doing that system, I took a guy that in his freshman season via training frequency had more exposures than a junior in college over his freshman year.
Yeah, you're training more, practicing more.
Exactly. You're practicing weights, right? And you're doing it in a controlled means. But the best part about this is it's not robbing them of their resources to get better at basketball.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask you. Because we do have – we run into an issue because with, let's say, for instance, mixed martial arts, they got to train multiple modalities throughout the day, not just in the week. So with that, I have to be very selective of what I do throughout that week. So I have to condense a lot in those time frames because I only may have them 2 times a week because of all these other demands. I would love to have the ability to, like you say, microdose and just have those little times where I can get them better at the movement patterns because then we can load them appropriately. Now, how is the coaches, like the coaches obviously are receptive to that. They like that. They're getting what they need out of the athlete and they're not taxed to do their practices because I know that's a major issue with a lot of skills coaches, right? They want them to be fresh for practice. So are you getting any, obviously they are more receptive to that, correct?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, that's where it's like a long discussion on the whole planning of the system. And that's one thing I think we run into the problem in team sports is people don't talk about it holistically.
Yeah.
Like at the end of the day, stress is stress. I don't care if it's practice stress, game stress, or weightlifting stress. Like it's all categorized as the same thing because the body doesn't internally know what's going on. It just knows it's getting its heart rate ramped up. It knows that it's experiencing load via high velocity or high load. So they're just, the body's just trying to find a way to find homeostasis, right? So as long as we're all on the same page, like for instance, another reason why to do that is to theme your day. So if we had like a game day, well, if I'm doing a lift with the guys on game day, which that was the beautiful part about microdosing is we lifted every game day. When you lift on game day, what kind of lift are you going to do? Are you going to do like 3 rep max or German volume training? Maybe not. You know, certain guys, maybe you could do some, you know, 3 rep maxes, but other guys, you're probably doing more speed based stuff anyways. You're doing stuff to get them ready to do their sport. And then days where you're doing heavy practices, well, yeah, you want to have a complementary stress to that, which could be your heavy 3 rep maxes, right? And then days that you're just seeing the net move, right? You're just in there just getting shots up. Probably should be get a lot of accessory work in, get a lot of blood flow, and that's restorative in nature. So that's where your 1x20s can come in. So that's where you want to feed what the stimulus of the day is. So if we are trying to, you know, here's a better example. If you're trying to develop better skill,
mm-hmm.
The last thing I'm going to do is hit them with high volume, high intensity at the same time, right? Like it's going to blow them out. Like they have no chance of developing new skill because I just disturbed the system. What can I do to actually increase that though? Well, the way I could do that is by doing a lot of speed work, right? Doing a lot of drills for self-organization and being able to facilitate an environment for learning. So now once they hit the court, they're like, I mean, they're like a sponge at that point. Whatever stress you throw at them, they're going to be able to do it at high velocities and high retention, because their body is primed to do learning. You know, that's what I think, that's where a lot of people miss the boat, is they don't want to complement what the sport is. They just go, well, this is the weight room, so we're going to clean, snatch, you know, back squat, front squat, because that's what weightlifting is. And it's like, yeah, I understand what weightlifting is, but until there's a squat rack on the court and you get points for lifting the most weight, that doesn't matter.